Hi guys, my name is Heidi, and if you don't know me, I am the Kids and Youth Intern here at St Mike's. Thanks so much, Fran, for that reading. Today, James and I are going to do a bit of a tandem-y talk on Jesus's triumphal entrance as seen in the Book of John. So what I love about this passage is the complete excitement and joy, but total misunderstanding that the pilgrims have of who Jesus is. They cry out, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." And they're waving palm leaves as well, which was like a nationalistic sign of pride and triumph and victory shown for a new king. They were expecting Jesus to be an earthly king that was going to lead them out of oppression under the Romans. But Jesus didn't come to be an earthly king. He came to be an eternal king. We see in verses 14 and 15 of this bit, where it says, "Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it is written, 'Fear not, daughters of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt.'" Now, this prophecy was from the book of Zechariah, chapter 9, verse 9, and it was given to Zechariah over 500 years before it is fulfilled here. God spoke this prophecy through him just as the Israelites were coming out of exile from Babylon. So they were returning home and rebuilding their city. But their enemies were still very real, and they continued to be so up until where we are now here in John. So when I first read this passage, I was thinking that the pilgrims were idiots. I was like, how could you miss the fact that Jesus is riding into Jerusalem on a colt, as it says in scripture, and you completely miss the point? Like, how does that happen? But then as I was reading a bit more into it, I realised that actually they still hadn't seen the fruit of that prophecy made 500 years ago. And in the meantime, they'd been under oppression and threats from the enemy, and they'd been living in a struggle. So, you know, we're human, they're human. It could have been very easy to have been blindsided by their earthly struggles and have been so helpful for some salvation from what was an earthly struggle that they missed the whole point of what Jesus was doing. So from that point, I'd love to take you to the last verse in this passage, verse 19, and it says, "So the Pharisees said to one another, 'See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him.'" Now the Pharisees, whilst they may not have been the best example of good intent, their job description was to live a faithful servant life to God, to bring God the glory, to do his kingdom work, and to encourage others to do and live the same. But here we see that their concern is about themselves. It's not about the excitement of what God is doing or what Jesus is doing, but it is about worry for themselves. When they say, "See, this is getting us nowhere," they're living a life that should be for God and for his people, but what they're doing is being worried about themselves and how they are perceived and their power. Now, I'm not saying that we all have a power complex, but how often have you yourselves felt discouraged after sharing your faith or sharing Jesus with others? I don't know about you, but I get this a lot. That feeling of, this is getting me nowhere. I've been a Christian for nearly 5 years now, and my family don't have a faith, but we have a lot of dinner time conversations about faith. And over these 5 years of, there must have been hundreds of conversations, I don't really feel like I've ever seen any fruit from that. And more often than not, I'll leave those conversations feeling really discouraged and just thinking, what is the point? Like, I am getting nowhere. This is getting me nowhere. But what I think is so helpful and so encouraging about this passage is it's a real reminder that it is not about the me, the I and the us. It is about what God can do through us. God's people had to wait 500 years to see the fruits of his promise. Zechariah, it was his own prophetic word. He never got to see those fruits. But what we do know is that we serve a faithful God who keeps his promises and who can do more with us than we can ever imagine. God may be sowing seeds when we share Jesus with others, seeds that we never see, or it could be seeds that we see in years to come, or it could be that those seeds are only ever seen between that person and God. But what this passage tells us is that God never breaks his promises. He is faithful to us, and he has a deep longing to be with us and to save us. So even if we don't see the fruit of our efforts or of God's promises in our own timelines, keep going, because even 500 years later, God pulls through in the most incredible way. King Jesus riding on the back of a colt into the temple of God. I'm now going to pass on to James, who is going to continue to talk us through this passage, hearing what God has to say.
Heidi, thank you so much for that. It's always a pleasure to hear your insights. So I've always appreciated a good story. I love imagining scenes and placing myself in them, picturing the drama and the excitement of the events being portrayed. And this is a passage which really, really benefits from doing that. As Heidi explained earlier, this act of Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a donkey was the fulfillment of a prophecy made by Zechariah centuries prior. It had huge implications to the Israelites, as they had certain hopes and expectations that went along with this. And the Old Testament is full of prophecies about a coming Messiah who will redeem Israel from the tyranny they so often found themselves in. They had waited for centuries for this coming king, and the general expectation was that he would be a nationalistic military ruler who would overthrow the Roman Empire and make Israel a world power once again. You can imagine and understand the excitement, therefore, that went along with this. And when the Israelites saw Jesus fulfilling their prophecy, they were overcome with elation. They finally saw what Zechariah had foretold, and their shouts and their cheers of "Hosanna, Hosanna" can become all that much clearer in our minds. However, the excitement and praise towards Jesus did not last all that long. The Israelites had hoped for Israel to be restored, but their expectation of what that would look like differed from the plan which God had had. While the Israelites expected a physical kingdom to be restored, God had the plan of a spiritual kingdom coming to earth, where both the spiritual and the physical are intertwined in this wonderful, beautiful cosmic marriage. This would be a time where true salvation was offered to everyone, the Jews and the Gentiles, and that would include the Romans, who were seen to be the oppressors of the Jews. Obviously, this wasn't met very well, and the same people who shouted "Hosanna" would just a few days later shout "Crucify him." Jesus did not meet the expectations that were being projected upon him. And because of that, many of the Israelites believed that he would not be the one to restore Israel. So, how often do we do this today? Do we get despondent when our hopes and prayers are not answered or fulfilled in the ways we think they ought to be? I'd be lying if I said I didn't do this. I have a vision of how I think the world ought to be, how I think God should be doing his job. But I'm often not happy when God goes in a different direction. The more I think about it, the more I can relate to the Israelites than I'd like to admit. However, as you and I both know, Jesus was indeed the one who would restore not only Israel, but the whole world. His death and very real resurrection attest to this fact. And the way in which he brought about this restoration to mankind was unthinkable. and usurped every expectation held by anyone. But I believe that this plan was better. It was a plan of love and of peace. It was holistic and better than anything any of us could ever begin to fathom. There is something about the finality of the resurrection which I believe shows that our hopes and expectations are held in the palm of God's hand. So, when things don't go the way we think they ought to, do we still trust in God's redemption? Maybe right now you're feeling tired, fed up, or just the very idea of hope seems too distant to grasp onto. Perhaps you're afraid that trusting God now will leave room for future disappointment. I've been there. And if you are too, may I encourage you to put your hope in Him again. We're going to head into a time of worship shortly. And as we do, I encourage you to think about all the times where God has come through for you in the past. God is at work. God has always been at work. And God will continue to be at work. It may not be how you or I expect, but I do believe it is far better than you or I could ever fathom. As Kevin leads us in a time of worship now, let's take some moments to ponder these truths.